And the presentation I'm giving today is part of a larger manuscript project. And the reason I chose to kind of present this project here is that I remember I came from my job talk, I think in this very room, and mentioned in it that I had that part of my project focuses on the blues. And Scott Brown said, "You should have played some blues. Why didn't you play it?" So I thought I would do that today. And it's entitled Sabotage Soundtrack, Critical Blues Feminism and the Southern Chain Gang.
I'm a Keith and Susan,
Susan, yeah.
I'm a Keith and Susan,
Susan, yeah.
Better look out, Susan,
Susan, yeah.
I'll catch you reckless,
Susan, yeah.
Hi, someone does,
Susan, yeah.
Hi, someone does,
Susan, yeah.
I'll catch you reckless,
Susan, yeah.
Better look out, Susan,
Susan, yeah.
I'm a Keith and Susan,
Susan, yeah.
I'm a Keith and Susan.
A warning disguised as play, a protest, a collective action, a break from work, a revision. Susie Gow reflects collective recognition of the omnipresent danger of violence against black women. It revises a ring song that, according to Lewis Jenkins, was sung during slavery. Led by Edna Taylor, women imprisoned at Parchman Penitentiary sang Susie Gow and were recorded by renowned folklorists John Lomax and Herbert Halpert. Lomax and Halpert traveled to Mississippi's Parchman Penitentiary in 1936, intending only to record the men imprisoned there. But just before they left, they noticed the women and recorded 24 songs. These songs, along with those of more well-known blues feminists, including Sarah Martin, Victoria Spivey, Bessie Smith, and Gertrude Ma Rainey, were epistemological challenges to white supremacist patriarchy. This epistemological sabotage took the form of critiques of the law, legal doctrine, imprisonment, gender violence, and traditional gender roles. The singers imprisoned at Parchman could not escape to a juke joint and dance the night away as they might have if they were on the outside. Instead, they created original songs and revisions that articulated the circumstances of their lives and their ideas about the law, inaugurating an intellectual tradition that would be expanded by critical race feminists in the late 1980s and 1990s. Epistemological sabotage was accompanied by workplace sabotage, a diverse set of strategies through which imprisoned women interfered with capitalist production in the convict camp. Examining the array of resistance strategies employed by working class black women reveals the relationships between sexual, economic, and racial oppression, as well as a longer genealogy for black feminist legal critique than is usually acknowledged. Both current and historical critiques of law and punishment have the potential to contribute to abolitionist analyses of the prison industrial complex. Since blues feminism and critical race feminism emerged in historically analogous moments of prison expansion and state violence. From the 1910s to the 1930s, the Southern Chain Gang was an incubator of industrial capitalist growth and a fixture of the emergent New Deal state. While in the contemporary period, massive prison expansion functions as a fix, to use Ruth Wilson Gilmore's term, reconciling the crisis of neoliberalism, growing unemployment and underemployment, and the emergence of a militarist state that simultaneously widens and disavows state power. Gilmore calls this the anti-state state, which at once circulates a discourse of small government while expanding military, police, and imprisonment power, creating what is arguably the largest prison project in the history of the world, one in which women of color are the fastest growing prisoner population. Lou's feminist critiques of punishment confronted the juridical logic that grounds the penal regime in both moments, challenging it with narratives about subject position, destabilizing juridical claims to objectivity, and circulating alternative narratives of social experience, all features of critical race feminism. Black Feminist Blues provides an alternative archive upon which to construct a broader history of gender violence, gendered regimes of imprisonment, and resistance that is largely invisible in more traditional archives. The 1920s and 1930s represent the era of blues and the era of the chain gang. Chain gang punishment was established in Georgia as a reform of convict leasing. And I won't go into the history of convict leasing here, but I assume most people will be familiar with it. But on chain gangs, imprisoned women and men were forced to work for the state, primarily in county road maintenance and construction. By 1916, Georgia had 13,000 miles of surface road, more than any other southern state and fifth largest in the country. Virtually all of that road was constructed through chain gang labor. If the symbol of the modern industrialized America shifted in this moment from the railroad to the automobile, women and men on the chain gang, almost all of whom were black, literally paved the way for southern development and the transport of southern goods and people within and between the state. Women's blues exploded in this era and was itself a criminalized cultural practice. In 1922, police women in Atlanta visited theaters 1,071 times and dance halls 50 times, arresting young black women. That year, in 1922, black women were twice as likely as white women to be arrested in Atlanta. And throughout the 1920s and 1930s, black women were arrested at 2 to 3 times the rate of white women in Atlanta. Once picked up by police, white women were usually able to pay fines to avert chain gang sentences, while black women were forced to serve days, months, or years on the chain gang. Nearly 2,000 black women were sent to Georgia's chain gangs in the 1910s and 1920s, compared with only 4 white women. Even at the State Farm, where white women were sent instead of the chain gang, black women were still dramatically overrepresented there. Between 1928 and 1936, the number of black women at Georgia State Farm varied between 143 and 197 black women per year, while the range for white women was between 14 and 28. So you can see that white women were not merely protected from the chain gang, although they were, and that was codified in the law that created the chain gang, an exclusion for white women. But they were protected from imprisonment and the humiliation and violence of imprisonment generally. According to David Oshinsky, the same was true at Mississippi's infamous Parchman Penitentiary. Black women's deviation from normative femininity was reiterated and reinforced through their subjection to the terror of Georgia's chain gangs and its State Farm. And terror it was, characterized by whipping, overwork, medical neglect, housing in 9 by 9 foot cages, being hit by rifles, consuming rotten food, and bug infestation. In 1915, a Fulton County grand jury reported that the Fulton County women's convict camp was overcrowded, but county authorities refused extra expenditures for camp facilities that would have improved conditions. In 1920, prisoners complained of indiscriminate beatings, being worked in the rain, and drunken guards. In 1909, Essie Coleman and Hazel Lewis, both black women, received 6 lashes for disobedience in the Tifton County chain gang. The Fulton camp held the largest number of women prisoners in the state, and in 1909, at the Atlanta stockade, a 13-year-old black girl wearing only 2 thin undergarments was whipped. After she was released, the girl became hysterical and said something unintelligible to the superintendent, who beat her again. In the context of inhumane living conditions, debilitating workloads, and sexual violence from white male prison guards, imprisoned women developed myriad strategies of resistance, both individual and collective, everyday and extraordinary. as Tara Hunter has uncovered, domestic workers in Georgia adopted numerous tactics of rebellion, including pan-toting, work slowdowns, and borrowing. Such infra-political practices have, as Robin D.G. Kelly has influentially argued, characterized black working class resistance. They consist of the, quote, daily confrontations, evasive actions, and stifled thoughts that often inform political movements. Women imprisoned in Georgia's convict camps engaged in infrapolitics and were routinely beaten for violations, including disobedience, cursing, fighting, burning clothes, idling, bad plowing, and fooling the doctor. The archive of terror that whipping ledgers represent reveal quotidian forms of rebellion practiced by black women inside Georgia's punishment regime. Burning one's soiled clothes and tattered clothes to keep warm during the coldest month of the year, as Nora Daniel and Molly White did, is a means of survival, clearly, but it's also an act of defiance of the mandate that imprisoned women live and work in subhuman conditions marked by cold, filth, scarcity, and the refusal to wear soiled and tattered clothes, which they would also have been responsible for mending and washing, since black women were forced to do the domestic work for the convict camp in addition to all of the other work of road construction. Burning clothes is political sabotage, undermining an ideological order that positioned black women on the outskirts of the human family, and therefore requiring fewer resources than fully human subjects. Such acts were also workplace sabotage, interfering with the quantity or quality of capitalist production. It is fundamentally the withdrawal of efficiency. And this is a pamphlet published by the International Workers of the World in 1918 on sabotage, which was quite controversial and they later disavowed. But some of the women who were punished for idleness or bad work were also whipped for outright insubordination. Kate Clark, Molly White, and Lila Burgess were all whipped for both idleness and disobedience. Laura Hurd was beaten for both impudence to a guard and bad work. As with arrest records, we must be careful not to assume that the women who were unmercifully beaten by prison guards actually did the act for which they were punished. For example, a whipping ledger that cites fooling the doctor as a woman's crime may be a reflection of a strategy to avoid grueling labor, that is, going to the hospital ward if there was one. There wasn't always, rather than working, but it also may reflect callous indifference, right, by the guards to an actual sincere illness. Despite the uncertainty of the archive, it is clear that at least some of the women did defy guards, feign illness, and deliberately fell short of the extreme labor demands that they were given, sabotaging work from which they were profoundly alienated. And Aisha Finch has done amazing work on the archive and resistance. Although she was only 16, Teresa Williams probably knew that escape was her only chance to avoid the brutal Daugherty County chain gang. She was convicted of malicious mischief in 1918, along with two other black girls, Hattie Bishop, who was only 11, and Gladys Trumbick, who was only 12 years old. They were charged with, quote, unlawfully and with force and arms, willfully and maliciously destroying the flower pots and flowers of three white residents in Albany. In Albany, Georgia, that is. And they were sentenced to 1 year on the Daugherty County chain gang. Teresa, Hattie, and Gladys attempted a second act of sabotage, escaping from the chain gang by destroying the floor of the stockade. They were caught by a guard, and with their escape thwarted, Teresa, Hattie, and Gladys had to serve their entire term on the chain gang for allegedly destroying flowers. The hardship of life on a southern chain gang was the subject of Georgia Stockade Blues, recorded by singer Sarah Martin in 1924.
Are all
And unfortunately, because of time, I can't play the entire song for each one that I'm talking about today, but you can read the lyrics if you want. This song is, in many ways, emblematic of blues feminist representational strategies. As Angela Davis argues, naming social problems and honest, realist depictions were central elements of the blues idiom and protest strategy. Indeed, Sarah Martin's unflinching representation of the horror of the stockade, of swollen muscles, of shackles, of interminable years, of merciless judges, of unfeeling juries, of vicious guards, is in keeping with the honesty that defines black feminist blues depictions of life and of punishment. By recording a song composed by and made famous by blues singer Tom Delaney, she revises a dominant narrative, injecting black women's experiences and the issue of gender oppression into a field usually defined by masculinity. The iconic male blues singer and the paradigmatic black male target of imprisonment. Her performance creates a new song that illuminates white supremacist patriarchy. The song depicts a woman who is not protected from traditionally male forms of work, whose lack of protection and confinement in the chain gang reflects her proximity to masculinity in the white imagination and exclusion from normative womanhood. White womanhood in this moment, and as I've said, is constituted in part through protection from imprisonment and the chain gang specifically. It was a property interest. Whiteness, as Cheryl Harris argues, is something that can be both experienced and deployed as a resource. Thus, a white person used and enjoyed whiteness whenever she took advantage of the privileges accorded to white people simply by virtue of their whiteness. White women benefited from the property interest in whiteness when they were sent to the state farm instead of the chain gang. The fact that it was an inalienable right, one not easily disavowed, does not diminish its definition as property, for as Cheryl Harris notes, classic property law incorporates the idea that certain inheritances are not easily relinquished. As Clyde Woods argues, the blues was an epistemology, a system of representation and explanation, the foundation of which rested upon the, quote, constant reestablishment of collective sensibility in the face of constant attacks by the plantation bloc and its allies, and in the face also of daily community life that is often chaotic and deadly. In her Woman's Trouble Blues, Bessie Smith represents the gendered and racial specificity of punishment and carceral violence. Unlike her Sing Sing prison blues, which we'll hear later, and jailhouse blues, Woman's Trouble Blues is not a punishment-themed song. Instead, it inserts the reality of punishment into the chaotic and violent predicament of being a black working-class woman.
When a woman gets in trouble, everybody's bold.
So here, jail is positioned alongside other key themes in black working women's lives in the 1920s, the difficulty of relationships, migration, and movement. And Smith asserts that imprisonment was a woman's problem or trouble. It's consistent with Martin's Georgia Stockade Blues, a reconceptualization of punishment, not as necessarily only or primarily impacting black men. She links punishment to the domestic sphere in other songs, such as In the House Blues, where she sings, "Can't eat, can't sleep, so weak I can't walk my floor. Can't eat, can't sleep, so weak I can't walk my floor. Feel like hollering murder, let the police squad get me once more." In Woman's Trouble Blues, juridical cruelty is as important as the economic incentive for punishment. Although she had the money to pay, the judge wouldn't accept her fine. And the cruel judge is a trope in black women's blues, including several songs by Gertrude Ma Rainey, and in Penitentiary Blues, which is a group song sung by several women imprisoned at Parchman Farm. And the bold is where they're singing. So here we see the trope of the cruel judge again. In her No More Freedom, Eva Thomas analyzes the terror of constant police surveillance and capture, radically deconstructing the objectivity of the law.
Standing on the corner of No Ferris and Church Street, when that old big bad policeman came up and arrested me. When those jurors found me guilty, that old mean clergy wrote it down. I could tell by the people that I was Parchman bound. No freedom, no more good times in this wide, wide world for me. Oh, I'm deep for my freedom and I'm sick as I can be. But someday, yes, someday, someday I will go free. I'm gonna treat all you people just like you treated me.
Here, Thomas undermines the binary between innocence and guilt that is the foundation of legal doctrine with the line, "I was standing on the corner." Why she was on the corner, whether she was a vendor, sex worker, mother waiting for her child, or waiting to cross the street, is left unspoken, troubling the listener's ability to surmise her innocence or guilt. We hear yet another commentary on the arbitrariness of the law, the complexity of a woman's relationship to prosecution, and a refutation of the criminalization of black womanhood. Her action, or the alleged crime, is not the primary issue, but rather the action of the big bad policeman, whose characterization as both big and bad reverses the subject position of defendant and accused. She's accusing him here. She condemns the legal system at every stage, the big bad policeman, those jurors, the mean old clerk, both with the register of her voice and in the culmination of her story, the loss of her freedom. Alongside the cruel judge in Smith and Rainey's songs, the certainty of Thomas's imprisonment at Parchman manifested in the big bad policeman and all of the other legal actors. In Thomas's judgment, it is the opinion of legal actors about black female subjects rather than the objective decision-making that condemns black women to penal torture. By insisting on the subjective decision-making and deconstructing the legal personality, blues feminists anticipate the concern of critical race feminists and feminist legal theorists. As critical race scholar Angela P. Harris explains, quote, "Legal thinkers have veered toward a voice which speaks from the position of objectivity rather than subjectivity, neutrality rather than bias. The voice, like the voice of we the people, is ultimately authoritarian and coercive in its attempt to speak for everyone. Blue's feminists' proclamation that the law did not speak for them, representations of juridical meanness rather than objectivity, or objectivity as meanness, is an epistemology reflecting the violence ingrained in Western legal doctrine, and demystifying the law and its actors as unmediated voices and reasonable entities. They anticipate the radical paradigm shift of legal scholar Patricia Williams in her 1991 classic text, Alchemy of Race and Rights, which opens with the assertion, "Subject position is everything in my analysis of the law." This is a profound shift in the way we're supposed to think about how the law operates. And she argues that it operates by the drawing of bright lines and clear taxonomies that purport to make life simpler in the face of complication. Rights versus needs, moral versus immoral, public versus private, white versus black. It operates through the existence of transcendent, acontextual, universal legal truths or pure procedures, through the existence of objective, unmediated voices by which those transcendent, universal truths find their expression. Smith and Thomas provide a longer genealogy for Williams' now classic critique of the law, underscoring the complexity and perhaps the irrelevance of the guilt-innocence binary in the face of life's complications by cloaking the details of the crime. Bessie Smith's powerful Sing Sing Blues also illuminates the role of subjectivity and subject position in the law.
All the good fancies tell me my lawyer pleading left with me. The judge said, "Listen, Bessie, tell me why you killed your man."
What Bessie Smith does really profoundly, I think, is argue for a different standard for legal decision making, and she anticipates an argument that feminist legal scholars begin to make in the 80s and 90s and 2000, which is an argument for a reasonable woman standard under the law, particularly for adjudicating domestic violence, rape, and sexual harassment cases. And I think here is a really early and profound and important articulation of that, that reasonability is not universal, that we need a woman standard, and that in fact, she's going to refuse to participate in this defense because the standard of the law does not recognize her. She also illuminates a modern juridical principle in which, according to Michel Foucault, it is the criminal, not the crime, that is in need for determining the sentence. The judge's positionality as executor and his incapacity to recognize Smith as fully human is emphasized by the dirge-like quality of the music that plays after the judge issues his demand for her to speak. She refuses to be part of her condemnation. To Foucault, quote, "The magistrates and the jurors, the lawyers too, and the Department of the Public Prosecutor, they cannot really play their roles unless they are provided with another type of discourse, the one given by the accused by himself." Smith recognizes the anxiety that her refusal induces with the line, "You can send me up the river or send me to that mean old jail. I killed my man and I don't need no bail." Foucault asserts that the absence of a discourse about oneself throws the court into flux. Quote, "They urge, they push the accused. He does not play the game. He is not unlike those condemned to the guillotine or the electric chair because they drag their feet. They really ought to walk a little by themselves if indeed they want to be executed. They really ought to speak a little about themselves if they want to be judged." If the subject is at issue in Foucault and Smith's theorization of the operation of modern law and punishment, the blues provided a platform through which black women could explain the particular ways in which the law functions to expose them to particular forms of terror, while simultaneously being exposed to the violence and the workload that all prisoners faced, including men. Caught in a bind of sameness and difference where gender becomes unintelligible, they were, as Hortense Spillers has put it, female flesh ungendered.
Go away, devil, devil, leave me alone. Go away, devil, devil, leave me alone.
This song gives expression not only to the experience of women at Parchman, but the experience of thousands of black women across the South who were in convict camps, including Hattie Johnson, who argued in her clemency application in 1912 that they were nothing but all men and me, one woman, and they carry me out on the road every day like I was a man. This issue of sameness, right, with male prisoners. Black women in southern convict camps were trapped by the sameness manifested in labor exploitation, which located them in close proximity with men. But they were also exposed to violence and violation that were both gendered and racially specific.
Well, I know I done wrong, but he kicked me in black.
Between 1909 and 1936, 40% of the women convicted of murder, attempted murder, or manslaughter in Georgia claimed to be defending themselves against abusive husbands or sexual assault in their parole and probation applications. The number of women acting in self-defense may be even higher than that, because in some parole and probation documents, the cause of the crime was not specified. They were convicted because they were women and because they were black, a position at odds with vulnerability to violence. Spivey's protagonist articulates this reality, facing abuse at home, attacked by bloodhounds, and death by electrocution. Interestingly, Bloodhound Blues conveys a measure of regret. She knew the crime was wrong and only did it in a passion. Still, she reiterates the reason. I know I'd done wrong, but he kicked me and blacked my eye. In asserting the legitimacy of responses to violence in passion, she is rejecting what Patricia Williams terms the idiocy of high objectivity, or the capitulation to a norm that refuses to allow for difference. She is articulating what critical race feminists contend is ignored and negated through the law, that is nuance. They argue for a dismantling of clear dichotomies between something like reason and passion, the necessity for a standard of reason that incorporates the reality of lives, of the lives of people of color, women, and women of color. Passion here is reasonable, there isn't that dichotomy. And the standard for reasonability is her experience of gender violence and the threat of more to come. Importantly, Spivey does not portray this experience as extraordinary, reflecting, "I thought it was a fashion." Fashion here is a clever double entendre conveying both the idea of a trend, or the prevalence of black women's resistance to male violence, but also a fashion, or a method of resistance. Spivey's analysis presents an important moment in the genealogy of black feminist critique of the law, both substantively by privileging the issues of gender violence and deconstructing universal standards for objectivity, but also methodologically, a way of seeing the law's complexity through irony, dialogue, storytelling, personal experience, lyricism. Adrian Catherine Wing argues that such narrative techniques are central to critical race theory. They are exemplified, again, by Patricia Williams' methodology of parody, parable, and poetry. The notion, right, that this emphasis on linear argumentation that defines the law can be disrupted through something like parody, song, humor, storytelling. Bloodhound Blues also pierces the silence that legal scholar Kimberly Williams Crenshaw has critiqued through her analysis of the critical need for structure and political intersectionality. Crenshaw argues with respect to political intersectionality that women of color have been silenced about domestic violence for a couple of reasons. It's considered either the byproduct of racism or a threat to the black community, reinforcing stereotypes of black male pathology. Because of this, people have widely criticized representations such as Alice Walker's The Color Purple and the character of Celie. And Crenshaw argues that The depiction of Celie's oppression, which stemmed from the interaction of race, gender, and class, was undesirable in 1982 when it was published, and 1985 when it was represented on film. If Sarah Martin revised the traditional notion of black men as the sole targets for white supremacist violence in Georgia Stockade Blues, her fellow blues conspirators, Bessie Smith and Victoria Spivey, addressed intraracial domestic violence explicitly in their songs, creating a soundtrack of intersectional, radical theoretical interventions that anticipate critical race feminism.
Baby blues. Yes, we are talking about the danger blues. If I had me a pistol, I'd be dangerous too. Yeah, you may be a bullet, but I don't know. But I'll fix you so you won't. You won't wash no clothes. Yeah, that woman don't do nothing but walk the room. My knee bone hurt me and my ankles swell. Says I may get better, but I won't give way.
I'm going to skip forward a little bit, but you can see here Maddie Mae Thomas linking the oppressiveness of traditional gender roles and the prevalence of rape, which was also articulated in the song Rickety as Superintendent.
What you gonna do, babe, when it's that old house down?
So here we also see linking gender violence on the ostensible outside, on the way to school, with violence at the farm, escaping from the sergeant, and also, right, an argument for tearing the jailhouse down, which may seem fanciful and like a crazy utopian notion, but in 1900, actually, three imprisoned black women at Georgia State Farm conspired with a white woman, one of the few there, to actually burn down the women's section of the state farm, which they successfully did, which included the quarters of the warden of the state farm, who was notorious for sexually harassing the women there. They ended up being acquitted mostly because the prosecutors marched in to testify about a dozen black women, and the jurors acquitted all four of the defendants because they just couldn't convict this white woman on the testimony of these black prisoners, black women prisoners. Okay. So the last thing I just want to say very, very quickly is that I think that blues feminism as a precursor to critical race feminism provides a foundation, an important intervention in contemporary abolitionist thought. These women aren't arguing necessarily for the imprisonment of their abusers. They're clearly talking about the circumstances of their lives and the violence ingrained in the legal system, including in the Western doctrine that grounds the entire legal system. And they aren't arguing for something like better prisons, right? They're arguing for tearing the jailhouse down. And it really, that argument and that epistemology really jives with feminist abolitionist critiques today, in addition to critical race feminism. So just want to leave it there. Thank you for coming. And I'm sorry that this went so long, but I did want to make sure you heard as many songs as possible to get a range for the types of arguments that I'm talking about.
Question?
Mm-hmm. Delaina. Oh, sorry. Delaina and then Jordan.
I have a question about your use of terms.
Yes.
Some of the crimes that these women were committed for, or that were they were committed for committing, I mean, I wonder if it was ever clarified what they were in jail for. You mentioned mischief or immorality. Or very, that doesn't really carry any meaning. And so I wonder if in the laws it was elucidated what this actually means, or how much reading between the lines you have to do to understand what type of behaviors women were being incarcerated for.
Yeah, it really varies, although there is a lot of consistency over time. So when it comes to things like assault, attempted murder, the consistency of those acts being self-defense against domestic violence or against rape is really extends from like Reconstruction into the 1940s. That is the primary reason that black women went to prison for those kinds of crimes. And then there were local city stockades and chain gangs, and many black women were convicted for things like cursing, unruliness in public, and larceny for when it comes to misdemeanor city crimes. And then there's the period of prohibition in Georgia, which lasted longer than national prohibition. It actually lasted from 1908 to 1935. And black women were routinely picked up and given a wide range of sentences from 3 months to over a year for possessing whiskey. So things that we all do today, which, right? Many of us, some of us.
Sarah, thanks for this talk. It was fantastic. I love your lines. And I just wonder if you could say a little bit more about your analysis of the stakes involved in foregrounding blues feminism as an epistemological sabotage, phrase, and why it's important to think about the knowledge production of black working class women's critique of the prison regime in the long 20th century now. If you could just fill that out.
Sure, yeah. There are several reasons that I think it's important to understand this. One is that I think many people, and I've had conversations with some people in this room about this, feel like it's impossible, right, to understand the inner beliefs, desires, strategies, and theories of working class black people in general because of the problem of the archive. And I argue that in addition, right, to people like Bessie Smith, who people have worked on for a long time, in black studies and feminist scholarship, there are these women at Parchman, right, who are articulating something really important, something that's theoretical, and something that really corresponds with both individual and collective acts of sabotage, which are industrial acts, right, which the IWW claimed were important, right, labor strategies at the turn of the century. But also, there are just so many continuities here with the experiences, right, of black women in the legal system today. So I got into this project really because I was working before I went to grad school as a paralegal and seeing the lack of recognition or the lack of intelligibility of black women submitting things like sentencing memos and, you know, in helping work on those cases, right, they had to be either entirely abject, right, or entirely moral, going to church every day, married, taking care of their children in order to get any leniency, or they had to have every bad thing happen to them in the world and completely, utterly abject. And there was just this, and so there still is, right, this lack of recognition under the law for something like nuance and complexity, and that has the consequence of sending black women to prison for years and years and years for something like, right, stealing a check from an envelope, which are cases that I worked on. So, hi.
This talk was beautiful. This was so
Excitia.
We're going to be citing you up, down, and center very soon, and people are going to be fighting to get a hold of your book, and it's just, we're going to be able to say, you know, we have to sit to her talk at the podcast.
Thank you, Dr. Finch.
There's so much that I want to say. I mean, it's one of the things that's fascinating to me is how clearly you can see the trajectory and the maintenance of the exact same technologies of enslavement and confinement from the plantation south. I mean, almost unadulterated. And it strikes me, again, in terms of thinking about the you know, epistemological you know, interventions that these women are making. I remember from the very first slide, you actually showed a slave work song, I think, that was along the other side, that was actually mentioning this figure that comes up in the song, and it just occurred to me that's just such an amazing and profound intertextuality, and I think that you're really not only positioning these women as you know, kind of architects of knowledge production in a really, really critical way. But also there's a really important intertextuality, for lack of a better word. In other words, you know, there's all of these resonances that are so clear, and I mean, I know that you've, you know, thought about this, but it's just striking in terms of like the kinds of political consciousness that you know, working class black people and enslaved black people have been, you know, developing have been articulating for years and years. And if you would elucidate on that,
sure.
It's just sort of a comment, but one of the things that I was really intrigued by is just the creation of these songs, and I just wanted to hear more about that. Do you know more about the context that they emerged from?
Mm-hmm.
You know, the recording of them, primarily recording them, and this, you know, hear the male voice asks for another verse.
Right.
So, and so again, you know, thinking about, you know, what you're speaking of in terms of how these archives are created, and so there's this really fascinating interplay between a very particular purpose, it seems to me, for which these songs are being recorded, but at the same time, the songs themselves are allowing for this really transgressive and I think political, you know, space and voice for these women to, you know, very clearly and like you said, honestly, talk about, you know, the terror that they experience, the violence and things that are happening to them. So,
Yeah, I mean, it's really interesting. I think of someone, right, like Harriet Jacobs, who's expressing, like, the similar intersectionality of race and gender violence under slavery. I also think of, you know, your work and the different strategies of representing rebellion and resistance, right? There is song, there's rumor, there is the circulation of ideas about conspiracy, and these are gendered and class ways of sort of constituting social movements that I think continue from slavery through what Robin Kelly discusses, right? Working at McDonald's in the 1980s. And so it's one of the things that I think is so important to recognize a long-standing black political tradition of these kinds of protest traditions. There's also the context, which is profoundly different and similar at the same time. So, you know, if you think about resistance under slavery, which was simultaneously a racial and economic regime, right? The forms of sabotage that took place are both economic and epistemological. In this regime, right, we're thinking about nothing less than the development of industrial America. I mean, this is the foundation for the transport of goods and services in the South. It's the very infrastructure of that, of the road. And so thinking about both the prison regime and also strategies of resistance in those two moments are really important. And then today, right, we have the prison regime being the infrastructure for instituting neoliberal policies. So it's important to recognize the difference, right, between like strategies and economic orders for the formation of agricultural economies, industrial economies, and now post-industrial neoliberal economies. The very different economic orders, but there are many continuities between them, both in terms of the violence that necessitate that is necessary for them, but also these strategies of resistance which inform social movements. And you know, it took the state had to pay $4,500 in 1900 to rehabilitate the prison after they burned it down, which doesn't seem like a lot of money today, but was. And so there are mobilizations that, you know, work and build upon each other and sometimes start from something like a song, which seems completely utopian, or a whisper, right? Or a, you know, collective conversation.
I'm sorry. Would you care to speak about the...
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, yes. So so that is interesting and something I need to dig around more for in the Mississippi State Archives. But so far, what I've uncovered is really fascinating because Lomax and Halpert transcribe the songs. Makes me think about your issue of audience, right? So they transcribe the songs, and the transcripts are different from the recordings, which the recordings, there's more of an emphasis on sexual violence, particularly in prison, right? Which they wouldn't tell him when he was asking them to give them the lyrics, writing something written down, right, in an archive that seems so permanent, right, and can be used against them. But then when he's recording them, the lyrics change subtly. And they talk about the sergeant and rape. So he goes there twice. They go there twice, once in 1936 and once in 1939. Again, like I said, as an afterthought. And it's part of the Works Progress Administration. They're workers for the WPA, as are, ironically, right, the same sorts of workers who recorded the narrative of Susie Gal, right? It's from the WPA narratives, also remembered and recalled in 1936. So these are both WPA materials and workers who are recording and the at least immediate audiences for these productions, although of course they have a wider audience both then and now. So there was some fear around what they were saying, but I think with something that seemed as non-permanent as a song, although it was recorded, they were actually more explicit, which is interesting.
I got one more, if that's okay.
Yes, sir.
So you make this really interesting intervention about how whiteness was constituted through white women's exclusion from convict policing. I think this is in the 1930s, if I was following.
So the law establishing the chain gang is in 1908. And the first paragraph of the law provides for discretion when sentencing women, but that only applies to white women. So the law is constituted through this exception, but the chain gang lasts until the 1940s. So that's the rule from 1908 till 1940s.
So I just wonder if in your work, or if you could speak to it now, about how we could think about this as part of the counter-revolution against Reconstruction. I mean, the ways in which whiteness is actually, you know, being used to divide potential opposition, like you conclude with, you know, burning down the jailhouse. And if you see that as a part of this kind of revolutionary property that Du Bois talked about in Black Reconstruction.
Yeah, absolutely, because the icon of that counter-revolution, right, is white womanhood and vulnerability to violence and the necessity of protection against interracial sex, which was to destroy the entire economic, ideological, symbolic order of the South. So one thing that I think about that is that Black women's imprisonment in the chain gang, visible, right, working on the roads, helped define that symbol of white supremacy, that counter-revolution. After Reconstruction, it required this polarity of subject, white womanhood versus Black womanhood, and that helped make or constitute and reiterate what white womanhood was, to have Black women visibly, right, doing what is understood as like traditionally male work, right? So everyone else doing that work is male. And white women were in the separate category of exclusion. So it upholds for sure the symbolic resistance to the gains of Jim Crow, but also there's the very material, right? And there's the material and economic with respect to what this did for establishing something that I've starting to think about as Jim Crow modernity, right? Industrialization through the order of Jim Crow, but also this is what is used. So in the 1890s, a Black woman is sent to the chain gang for refusing to go to the back of the bus, right? So it's the means of enforcement of the actual Jim Crow laws, right? Establishing separation and inferiority. So any last questions? Some of you have heard this before in class, so it may be overly familiar. Thanks everyone for coming. Appreciate it.